is dark matter. So the hypothesis is, and it's very well supported by other observations, that this is a typical galaxy. Okay, this is a galaxy that's sitting inside the cluster. Okay, these are the bright blobs that we saw in the cluster image that I showed you. We think they have their own individual dark matter repositories around them. So these are the clumps. So we are trying to quantify how much of the dark matter in this cluster is distributed in that smooth blob that we saw earlier versus the clumps. Okay, how much is really in clumps? And the effect of these clumps is to cause these weak distortions. Notice that these blue galaxies, these blue bits that you see here, are distant galaxies that are behind the cluster that are getting aligned preferentially, stretched out and weakly aligned along where there is mass. So we're just trying to quantify how big this halo is typically, so how big the clumps are, and how many of these clumps we actually have.
Yeah, so how this, the figure that you showed that is distinct entities.
Yeah, they're not that distinct. There's no such sharp edge for these dark matter clumps. However, there are concentrations, and I'll show you a visualization, and I'll show you a movie where it will become clearer why we conceive of them as sort of sharp silhouettes. So once again, so this is a movie from one of my colleagues who works in Zurich and has, luckily for him, the fastest supercomputer, access to one of the fastest supercomputers in the world, which I don't. However, the work is beautiful. So what it's showing you here is the formation of structure in the universe. So we started out with an initial condition where the universe was dominated by dark matter, and this dark matter had few ripples in it to start out. So it's like the ocean with just a few ripples. And then you follow these ripples grow and they amplify because of gravity. So a ripple is really a region where you've concentrated, you have a little heap of dark matter and that has gravity, it attracts more stuff from around it and becomes a slightly bigger heap and so on and so forth. And the regions from which it's attracting stuff become devoid of dark matter. So they become these regions called voids. So what we just saw here is how a typical cluster of galaxies, I'll show the movie again, how a typical cluster of galaxies like that one assembles. So what is shown here, they're all dark matter particles. They're just mocked up to look like light, okay? So this is all dark matter. These are all dark matter blobs, okay? And they're all aggregating. They're merging, they're colliding because of gravity. So when two dark matter particles collide, what is really cool, because they don't stick to each other, they actually go past each other. Okay? Because dark matter is supposed to be collisionless. We think it's collisionless. It doesn't actually collide with itself. And if it sticks only because of gravity, nothing else. Because remember, the gas, so the molecules in this room, right, so the perfume that all of us are wearing, right, those molecules are sort of floating around. And they're going to hit the walls, and they're going to cause pressure, right? So, and they collide. They collide with each other, and they create pressure. It turns out dark matter has no pressure, so it never collides. So the only way dark matter aggregates, which we see here, is via gravity. So we now have a pretty good understanding of how structure forms in the universe, how you start off with those initial fluctuations and how they grow, and how this cluster forms. And what we'll end up seeing here at the end is a cluster that could look like this ABEL-2218, this image that I've been flashing for you, saying, you know, it's a beautiful cluster. This is sort of how a cluster like that assembles over cosmic time. And what you see here is a cosmic clock that's telling you how long it's taking for the structure to assemble. And it turns out these clusters assemble very recently in the universe, since they are the most massive objects. So what you end up seeing, what you see here are all these dark matter blobs. Okay, so what I have been trying to do along with my group is trying to see in this theory, so there's a theoretical prediction that says if you form a cluster that looks like that, okay, so a cluster which will look like this, it has two blobs, that's what we ended up, the last frame of the movie showed you two blobs and a lot of little pieces, right? We'll just see it one more time. Partly because I love it. Secondly, it's just so visually beautiful. And secondly, you know, it's very, very instructive because I think it really makes the point So you see a lot of these substructures, they're called small-scale blobs, really, clumps. They merge, some of them disappear, but a huge number of them survive at the end, right? So theory, so this is a theoretical calculation, theory makes a very, very strong prediction for typically how many of these blobs, these little yellow dots that you see, that should survive. What you see in yellow there in the center is the smooth stuff. Okay, dark matter, but still smoothly distributed. So theory predicts precisely how many blobs we ought to have. And it turns out the nature of dark matter has a huge bearing on how many of these clumps survive. So for example, this is a simulation that me and one of my students did, where if the dark matter is this cold collisionless stuff, which I told you has no pressure, it doesn't collide at all, then you find a lot of itsy-bitsy pieces survive. Okay? The same time, the same universe with a dark matter particle that has a little bit of pressure that sticks. See how much smoother it is. It's the same region of the universe. So you can tell the difference by counting the number of blobs and in detail how many blobs you have, what the masses of those blobs are, where they are, you can actually discriminate between these two forms of dark matter. So, as I'll show you results, our work has shown that this is not a dark matter candidate that is viable for our universe. And that this is the dark matter candidate. More complicated, more blobby one is really a better description of what we see in the universe. How did we do that? So by looking at the lensing effect, so I've been showing you this cluster, so I'm going to illustrate with the results that we have for this particular cluster. So as after using the light bending from the distorted images that we see, we can recreate the details of this lens that is doing the deformation. And this is what that lens looks like. So you have a smooth bump here of dark matter. So this is a dark matter map. A three-dimensional dark matter map. So you have a smooth lump here underneath, and on top of it, you have these little peaks, which are basically the blobs. And here, I've removed the smooth bump just to illustrate the blobs better, so you can see the blobs better. So what we can do now, with starting from a Hubble Space Telescope image, we can do the mathematical modeling using the distorted shapes of galaxies, knowing where those galaxies are. So we have their spectrum, so we know exactly where they are in three dimensions. We know where they are in space, we know where they are in distance from us. We can actually map the locations of all the blobs in these clusters. And here, we've not assumed anything further about the properties of our universe other than the fact that light propagates in it. Okay? We have not assumed that gravity is the only game in town, nothing. We have only assumed that light is bent by mass. And that is predicted by general relativity, which appears to hold rather well on these scales. Okay? And so we have now a map that tells us, that allows us to look at a particular region in the sky and say, okay, how many clumps do we have? Okay, and we can do an inventory of what the clumps are. And of course, the heights of these clumps tell you how massive these clumps are. Okay, so this axis is the mass of the clump, and this is the position of the clump. So the peakier a clump, the peakier, so this is the most massive clump in this cluster, and these are the second most massive clumps that you see in that pair. So what we can now do is go back and compare with the theoretical prediction, which is the movie that I just showed you. We can go look at a region of sky that is comparable to this cluster size, and we can match the number of clumps. And it turns out that, as I said, it's cold dark matter theory that exactly matches the predicted clumps, as it turns out. So we can rule out from the light bending warm dark, so those dark matter candidates that have pressure, that are sticky, are called warm dark matter candidates, as opposed to cold dark matter candidates, which are collisionless. So we can conclusively rule those out. Okay. So I just want to show you.
So yeah. What are those classified as? The ones you rule out?
They're warm dark. They could be neutrinos. Whereas the particle, yeah, it is confusingly, the particle that we all think is viable is called the neutralino. So it sounds like a neutrino, but it's different. So neutrinos, which are these low-mass, highly energetic particles that we know form in the universe, they also form in the lab, in lab experiments. They've been detected. We detect them from their absence, from the missing energy, because we know energy.